Good evening. Welcome to the April edition of Strapped In. I'm your host, Mike Feltenberger. And tonight, our special guest is 2014 World of Outlaw winner and 2015 All-Star Sprint Series winner and a very versatile driver in the open wheel ranks, Ryan Smith. Thank you for being here, Ryan.
Glad to be here.
We will get to him with a couple questions. Home viewer line 610-378-0426. Some weekly results down at the Grandview Speedway Saturday night. The small block modified winner was Dwayne Howard. The late model winner was Lou Egry Sr. And the sportsman winner was Brett Cressley. Out at Williams Grove on Friday night, the winner was Stevie Smith Jr. And at Linda Speedway, they brought ARDC in for the first time in 12 years. Winning that race was Danny Stratton. The 600 micro winner was Eddie Strada. Slingshot Tour winner was Cody Klein. And winning the 270s was Josh Stoyer. Upcoming events, Friday night, Williams Grove Speedway. Everybody's there as far as 410 sprint car racing. Saturday night at Grandview, you have your small block modified, your late models, and your sportsmen. Linda Speedway on Friday night, wingless 600 micros, 270s, and the slingshots. And Mahoning Valley Speedway will be hosting the slingshots and the speedsters for tour races. And they also have their patented pancake asphalt modifieds, and they also run the dirt modifieds up at Mahoning Valley Speedway. We have plenty of questions to ask Ryan. Home viewer line 610-378-0426. Ryan, you have driven many open wheel classes. Why did you choose to go into the 410 sprints?
Well, it's the elite. It's the elite class around here, Central Pennsylvania. Growing up racing micros, that was the ultimate goal. You know, that's where we ended up.
What class did you start in?
Slingshots.
And you
back
were
in 2000.
And you were a national champion in the slingshots.
Yep.
And then you progressed to the micros. And then, did you run any ARDC midgets
ran
in there?
Ran ARDC, Ford Focus, USAC stuff, USAC Silver Crown.
You ran up at Oswego in the Ford Focus midgets.
Yep.
Was it fun running on the asphalt up there?
Oh, yeah. Pretty used up asphalt, but.
Were you a champion in that class?
Yeah, two-time.
Now,
Northeast in 06.
That was that based out of, it's East Coast, right?
Yeah, it was Northeast Series, North Carolina Series, Florida. I won the Florida and the Northeast Series.
Okay. Here we go. How did you get hooked up with your racing teams? First with Don Kreitz Jr. in the sprints, and second, you're now with the Warco racing team. How did this all transpire?
Well, the Kreitz deal kind of started with an owner out of New York. He was running his 305, and he hired Donnie to come up and crew at Middletown. I think it was year 2011, I believe. And he came up, helped me out up there, and we pretty much hit it off right there. I mean, he liked how I drove, and we worked together well, so we put together a 410 deal for 2012.
Okay, and now Don's been known, he's a bottom feeder of what they call, he won't get off the bottom part of the racetrack. And I've seen you race plenty of times, and you race wherever the racetrack warrants you to get faster. Did working with him, did that change your driving style at all, Ryan, or was it basically they were going to set the car up as you wanted to drive it?
Well, I mean, the car was set up for that, but being a 410 sprint car, you got 900 horsepower, 1,400 pounds. I was much more comfortable on the bottom. I mean, it was slower down there, you know, we had a lot more room to the fence, and really that's the biggest thing I'm still trying to get better at is run the cushion up by the fence. It's tough to do, and, you know, so we're getting there.
Who threw the first slide job on you? Do you remember it?
I'm sure it was night one. I forget who it was, but yeah. There's been quite a few since then.
Have you learned that process yet?
Yeah, we're getting there. Yeah, it's what you got to do, man. I mean, it's.
But isn't there a time though, Ryan? If you pull a slide job, the guy knows it's coming, and he's going to come down and catch you.
Well, and you got to make sure you're going to clear him. You know, I've had times when guy threw a slide job on me, and I had to lift, or I was going to wreck.
Right.
You know, so it's just it's the way of racing.
Okay, you have mom and dad as racing people. Your mom was a national sprint car champion and your dad was a modified and sportsman driver. Did you learn anything from them along the way?
Well, racing's in the blood. I mean, it's just, that's what I eat, sleep and breathe. I mean, it's, my mom was actually better than my dad. They used to race together, that's how they met. And she beat him all the time. So I go to her for, you know, opinions.
Okay, Randy.
Yeah, when you worked with Donnie Kreitz, of course you had Davey Brown there, senior. Did they kind of get you through that learning curve faster? Did they kind of feed you real quick with information?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was more seat time, you know, and having a good race car under you. Mm-hmm. Because it takes 2 to 3 years to figure out what you really need.
Did they explain, like, we're going to set it up for this or for that, and you kind of knew what the setup was going
Yeah,
into?
I mean, I had a lot to learn. Okay. I was starting from scratch, and just being around Donnie in the shop and Davey at the racetrack, there's so much information to take in there. Mm-hmm. You know, the 30 years of experience Donnie and 60 with Davey.
Right, right.
You know, so I'm still learning, but it was definitely a really good learning deal.
But all the things that they taught you, you can take that now into this team you're
that's
with.
That's what I'm doing,
and
yeah.
Progress from there.
Yep, and I think that's why I run pretty good.
Okay.
Okay, Ryan, you made it known that you're going to follow the All-Star Sprint Series this year. Is this being used to get your name out to some of the other top-named sprint owners?
Yes and no. It's more of experience for me, hitting different racetracks. I've been at Williams Grove for 3 years straight, every Friday night. So, yeah. You know, like I said to you before, I really lacked running that foot curb that far off the wall when it takes big nuts, you know what I mean? So you get more tracks like that out there. And like last Saturday out at Wayne County, it was treacherous. I mean, you had to really, when you hit that cushion, you had to have the wheel spinning.
Well, these are all new tracks now to you, right? You never ran a lot of these tracks.
Right, that's the first time there. And it showed, you know, I finished 17th. But now next time I go out there in June, I know what to expect.
Okay, you won in Ohio, and you're the opener, I guess it would be considered the opener. What is, and this is a lot for a lot of racing teams, what was your total expense to haul from Kunkeltown out to Ohio and back, just in expenses?
Well, we burned up 2 tires. It's $400. about $400 in fuel. And then a hotel room, and it was about $1,000. Made 5. So that was a good trip. But
how about these weeks now? You go there, like you said, you finished 17th. You're going to have a lot of those, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Because the competition is tougher now.
Yes, but
can you swallow that and kind of learn? And
biggest thing we're looking for is, you know, if we can run the top 10 in points and stay there.
Right, okay.
You get your tow money. Mm-hmm. It's like $200.
Oh, okay.
So there's your fuel bills half paid for.
Sort of like what dirt does with modifieds. If you stay with the points.
Right. Yeah. Okay. And the way the purses are set up, I mean, we still got $500 for 17th.
Oh,
so
okay.
You still got your fuel bill paid for. And, mm-hmm. You know, it's a learning deal, and it costs money to do it.
Okay. Home viewer line, 610-378-0426. You won the World of Outlaw race at Port Royal last year. Did any of the Outlaw drivers come up and congratulate you, or did they consider you an invader and sort of shun you after you won?
Well, Donnie Schatz didn't come up to me. Darren did. Pittman did. A couple guys that I'm friends with, you know, Cody and all them guys came over and congratulated me. It was pretty cool. Really, I mean, that's still hasn't said that I won an Outlaw show, but it was pretty cool.
Do you learn anything from those guys? You know, do you go in and, you know, sort of mingle and mix and see what's going on? Or is that one of these deals where sort of everybody keeps the trailer to themselves?
I don't leave my trailer. I mean, I stay there all night. And, you know, you really got to worry about what you're doing at the racetrack. Don't worry about what everybody else is doing. And Donnie taught me that. I mean, he never leaves his trailer. Only look at the racetrack, you know, or go to the bathroom.
You don't do like Reamer, walk around a pitch and look at the hires?
No.
And
look at the I mean, if somebody's parked next to me, I look over there, but you know, I don't.
Oh, okay.
Don't walk up and down the pits.
Okay.
Okay. What is actually said at these all-star drive? I mean, I have a driver's meeting at the Action Track every week, but is there a different type of atmosphere or attitude when you go to a driver's meeting as, you know, compared to the World of Outlaws as the all-star sprints?
No, it's all the same. It's all the same. I mean, there's different, with the different format, a lot of questions and answers there, but a driver's meeting is a driver's meeting. I mean, they're all the same.
Does the All-Stars have single file after a lap in, or they go double file till a certain amount in the future?
Double file till, I think, halfway.
That's a lot better than single, spreading everybody out in the first lap.
Yeah. What kind of influence does Tony Stewart have now that he's the manager of the whole deal?
He was there the first night, I mean, with a headset on in the infield, you know, watching everybody's starts and all that stuff.
Okay.
He'd come around on the golf cart, talk to everybody.
Oh, you know, okay. I mean, so he's very accessible.
Just like a regular race director. I mean, it was pretty neat.
Hmm, okay.
Okay, the All-Star Series is basically a closer traveling group. They, venture out far as west as, like, Indiana or something?
Yeah.
And then you did down south. Is that what made your decision to follow them, the idea that you are closer to home with a chance of making, you know, a few more bucks as compared to going to maybe, you know, Lincoln or Williams Grove every week?
Like I said, it was the experience deal, new racetracks. And the way the schedule's set up, it's 49 races. Most of them are 2-3 race weekends. So it makes it worth it to make the trip out and and you still don't miss Knoxville, you still don't miss the National Open. There's a lot of big races there you can still hit. So the schedule is actually very well thought out, and it's a pretty decent schedule.
How did you convince your owner to do this? I mean, this traveling.
It was tough. I mean, we're still not convinced. You know, it's we're taking it week by week.
Oh,
so
okay.
If we can stay in the top 10 and keep running well, mm-hmm. and keep affording to go out there, we'll try and keep it going. But I'm still looking for help. I mean, the fuel bill, tire bill. You know, it's Worker Racing. It's a team effort.
Right.
A lot of little guys come together, put this team together. Mm-hmm. You know, I brought motors. Rob supplies cars. We had another guy buys tires. You know, I mean, it's just a team effort. So it's not like one guy's got all the money.
Oh, all right.
So
okay.
we kind of all got to sit down and talk about it and see if it's really worth it.
Okay.
Do you actually have a crew chief, Ryan?
Yes. Jeremy Bittner. He's from Lock Haven. He's been with me. This is year two of two and a half.
Since you went into the 94 team.
Yeah. Really starting to gel, him and I. I mean, it's it took halfway through last year to get him off the Jack Holden Shield setup that he was putting in it. And back to the Donnie Kreitz style of racing. And we're starting to run the same page now and starting to show.
Yeah, but for him, all these tracks are new also, right? I mean, he goes to...
Well, he worked with Jack.
Oh, he did? Okay.
They mainly raced out there, so...
Oh, so then he's familiar with it.
We'll have a little bit of insight
somewhat,
there.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay, now, who makes the final decision on when you come in from hot laps and prepare for time trials? You know, if you'll come in and say it's, you know, pushing in turn one and turn two and, you know, helter-skelter in three and four, does he oversee your whole lap around the racetrack, or do you have to relay information to him?
He's pretty good at seeing. I relay a lot of it, and really I make my own calls. I'm trying to coach him and what I like. So he's kind of overseeing how I set the car up, and it's working out pretty nice because he's now on the same page that I am, and now it's to the point where he's like, just drive the car, I'll set it up. So, and it's working for me, so you know, I can't complain about it.
Now, what is the smallest track that the All-Star Sprints run on? Is it a quarter mile?
Quarter mile, yeah.
So that's like
Wayne County, they call it a 3/8, but it wasn't much bigger than a quarter.
So that's like going out the Lindas or up to the action track with a wing on the top of a 410 sprint car.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
It's a lot of race car for a small track.
You raced against USAC's best at Richmond in the USAC Silver Crown Series. Why didn't you continue in the Silver Crown Series?
It came down to money. It's just, that was a $3,000 trip to get there, and then $2,000 in tires, and they only raced five times a year. Just couldn't afford to do it. It was like starting over every time we wanted to go racing with it. So I enjoyed it. I mean, that was a lot of fun.
But you did shake the troops up, though, because you were, what, second fast time?
Yeah.
And you had guys coming like J.J. Yaley and Darlin and all them were coming over the car wondering how this, you know, this kid virtually with no experience can set second fast time.
Well, they actually asked me if I was good enough to start up front. You know, you sure you want to start there? I said, yeah, I want to start there. You know, I earned it, didn't I?
Yeah.
You know, and actually we led first. 10 laps, I believe.
Yeah.
And then my crew chief, my old man, leader stuck in the right rear and started getting tight.
Does that scare you in a way, though? For anybody that doesn't know about Silver Crown sprint cars, it's like, what, 75 gallons of fuel sitting behind you? Doesn't that get a little scary knowing, you know, what you got behind you? And as the race goes on, the lesser fuel load, doesn't that change the whole complexity of the race car?
Well, you start the race off with 400 pounds of fuel behind you. New tires, so the car is like a dump truck for the first 10, 15 laps, and then like halfway through, the car is where you want to be, right. And it's perfect. And the last 15 laps, you got no fuel in the back, your tires are burned off, so it's like dirt race.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you said you ran the Ford Focus midgets up at Oswego on asphalt. Must you change your driving style completely on asphalt, or is there just something that you do or don't do to make the car go straighter instead of sliding like you do in dirt?
Well, it's just about keeping the car straight, being smooth. Asphalt's all about being smooth. And really, I took a lot of that when 410 racing with it because, like Donnie, right. He's smooth as silk. You know, I mean, that guy, that's what it's all about, is being smooth. To run the bottom like that, you got to be on your marks, real easy to throttle and the brake and real little bit of wheel. And that's just like asphalt racing.
Okay, you've run Slingshots, you run micros, did you run any 305 sprint cars?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think you went up at Orange County once, right?
Middletown and New
Egypt. Yeah. Did you run a 358 sprint?
I did last year, actually, for the first time at New Egypt against 360s.
You won that one, didn't you?
No.
But you won the end of this.
Yeah, I won the 410 show.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I ran them all. I ran a 360, 360 in New York for 10 shows with Gary King.
Okay.
I think that was 2010.
Now, is there, other than the engine, is there any other major difference in a race car? You got to have your big right rear tire and your wing and stuff up top. Is there any other major difference between running, say, a 305 and a 410?
Just the weight and the power. The race cars are the same. Tires are normally the same, pretty close. Wings are the same. And then it's just like the 358 has steel heads, 360s have aluminum heads.
Okay.
So we ran that challenge show in New Egypt.
Right.
And when the track was heavy, it was tough to keep up with them. You know, I had so much weight up on the top of the car, I wanted to dive on the right front. But once the track got slick, they had too much power.
It came right to you.
It came right back to me, I mean, started 18th, finished 6th, and was still going, just ran out of time.
Okay, you helped with your mom and dad up. They own S&S Indoor Speedways up in Stroudsburg. Did running on the indoor track give you a good feel of what you had to do in a race car? I mean, you're in an indoor track, it's small. You had to know when to hit the gas pedal. You had to know when to leave off. You had to know when to slow. Does actual, like, indoor racing and help you become a race car driver?
It's that deal there is all about being smooth. You know, and you're still using your brain, your foot, and your brake, and you're steering the wheel. You can't tear the wheels off it, but, you know, it's the same kind of deal. And if you can get smoother and smoother and smoother, it's the same kind of deal.
Okay. Randy?
So you get to the point like where it's a natural reaction, more or less.
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now you won, you said New Egypt, you won Port Royal, you won at Attica. Is there any win with the 410 that's more important than the other ones, or are you still looking for that big win?
I'll be honest with you, I want to win at the Grove. You
know, okay.
I spent 3 years there every Friday night. And the first year, it was like every Saturday morning I woke up like, why am I doing this? Because this is tough.
You were leading a couple of them, weren't you, that one?
Yeah.
Well, now, when you come in with the All-Stars at the Grove now, are you going to be like an outsider, or you feel at home there now?
I feel back at home, yeah.
Okay.
It's kind of like my home turf. But I don't know if they classify me as posse or All-Star now. But either way, it doesn't matter. I just want to win.
Okay.
Now, on these different racetracks, you have Lincoln, you have Port Royal, you have Williams Grove, you have Sealands Grove. Port Royal's probably the difference in all of them, because all the other ones are two long straightaways and paperclip turns. Are most of the All-Star Series tracks similar to the Williams Grove and the Port Royal, or are they closer to the Lincoln?
I'd say Lincoln, for sure. I mean, Ohio, I think the biggest track's Eldora, which I haven't been to yet, but Wayne County, Attica, they were 3/8, like Lincoln.
Okay.
Different kind of surface out there, though. It really gets dirty, but it never, you don't burn tires up. It always gets a big cushion.
So I was going to ask you, how many races or whatever does your right rear last, you know, at some of these tracks that you're visiting now compared to?
Well, even, I said it don't burn tires up, but we'll put a new one on Friday. You know, we may run that one in the heat race.
Okay.
But it's just, you're racing, you're spending all this money to race with these guys. You got to put new tires on.
Are the All-Stars all-time trial shows, right?
Yeah.
And then you run from there to the heats and then like that.
Which one nice thing with the All-Stars is you have to run the same right rear all night.
Oh, yeah, okay. like Lincoln does, more or less. Yeah,
they actually got away from it.
Now
you can put a new tire on every time you go out.
Okay.
So it kind of saves a little bit of money there, but it's kind of a tire game now because they have a soft tire,
okay.
A softer right rear that came out with this year, and the one we ran last year. So we got a time trial on the same tire that you're going to run a feature on. So you almost want a time trial on the harder one, figuring the track's going to be hard for feature time. But that's actually, we gambled at Attica and ran a soft tire.
Well, now, is your whole night based on the time trials? I mean, when you go out, you want to do your best in the time trials? Because that's going to have your starting position?
Well, the All-Star deal, not anymore.
No?
No. I mean, it used to be. But now they have it to the point where you time trial in your group. So
you time trial
against 8 other guys.
All right.
And that lines you up in your heat
race. So you're not individual. You go out with your heat
race. Well, no. You time one car at a time.
Yeah, but I mean,
that's with your heat race.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then you can still race your way in into the dash.
Okay.
So now it's not all about your time trial.
Okay.
It's a pretty nice setup, actually. I like
so it's not like a time dash. It's still one car out at a time.
Yeah.
But say heat two is 10 cars. Those 10 cars are going to go out back to back to back to back, and then the fast time starts up front in that?
They invert 4.
Okay.
So say there's 10 cars in the heat, you time 4th out of them 10, you start to pull. Then they'll take the two out of top two in the heat to the dash. Everybody else lines straight up for the feature.
Okay, so your dash actually lines your first 8 to 10 cars up, depending on.
So it's not like last year's style was if you time 20th, the invert 20 for heat race, you start on the pole, you win the heat, still start 20th in the feature.
Now, at the All-Star shows, how many are more or less like regulars? How many travel the circuit? Is there a good group of cars? Or
I mean, we had 30 at Wayne County, 40 at Attica. Probably 15 will come to Pennsylvania.
I'll say like 20, 25 or Invader 15, type guys. Or home come. Track guys, whatever you want to call them.
Yeah.
Okay, did many time All-Star champion Dale Blaney have anything to say to you?
Yeah, he came over to me Saturday. He was laughing about the racetrack because, you know, I've never been to something like that. And it was really hard to see where to cushion, where you had to run. Okay. And he was telling me, you know, kind of what I had to do. But he said, wait till it gets dark and they turn the lights on here because you won't be able to see. And it was dark. It was
so the lighting wasn't that good?
It was the lighting, and it was so dusty. I mean, I've never been on such a dusty racetrack in my life.
Now,
you could not see.
What do you do to combat that then, Ryan? Is you just try to follow the guy in front of you, pick a spot along the racetrack that you can, you know.
That must be like a weekly thing, though. I mean, everybody races there, so.
Yeah, they say it's normally not that bad, though.
Oh,
it's
okay.
It's just the first race of the year.
Oh, all right.
That's how it was,
okay.
You had to, that's why next time I go out there, I'll kind of know more what to expect.
Okay. You raced at Arizona this year?
Yeah.
And in the 94?
Yep.
What were the results of that?
Blew two motors up. We ran sixth one night. Started 18th, finished sixth. But the third night, I was leading the qualifier. First time the car probably hit the cushion because I'm not usually up there.
Right.
And it broke the crankshaft. So actually, Bobby Allen lent us a motor to finish the last two shows off, which was really cool of him. So we drove 2,500 miles to race out there. But we're coming home early.
Now, you were racing with the Blaneys, with the All-Stars. You're racing with Kinzer and Schatz and all them guys in the World of Outlaws. And you race with Hodnett and DeWeese in Central Pennsylvania. Do you find they have different driving styles, Ryan, compared to, you know, what you normally, you said Don's, well, we know Don's a bottom feeder, but do you see different driving styles in all these drivers in different series that they run?
Yeah, yes and no. I mean, you have your Central PA guys that you know, all right, Brian Monteith ain't going to come off the wall. Hodnett's going to be good wherever he runs.
Right.
You know, you kind of have a list of, you know, where everybody's going to be. Out in Ohio, I'm still learning. I have no clue where. I know Blaney, they call him the low rider.
Yeah.
So you don't know where he's going to be. But other than that, I mean, Danny Holcraver, he's usually a gasser. So I'm learning kind of where these guys run. And they all have their own attributes.
Okay. Now, when you go to Indiana, Ohio, or your tour races out west, how many engines do you take along?
I only have one. I'm actually hopefully going to pick the second one up tomorrow, but I've been running all year so far with one, and we're not even set up yet to change motors in the trailer, which I got to work on. But you know, I'd like to have one in the trailer at all times and get a beam put in so we can winch a motor out. You know, hopefully we don't have to change it at the track, but if need be, got to be set up.
Okay. Who did you replace in the Warco team?
Matt Mounts.
And
which, that was family. That was Rob's nephew.
Okay.
And he just got burned out, just didn't want to race anymore. Been doing it a long time, got married, and walked away. We're trying to get him back. He's a good shoe, and we still have a 358 car with his name there, on it there, and we're going to get back in it.
Okay. You said you want to run Eldora. Okay. Are you going to take a trip out to Knoxville and give that a try one of these years, or?
We'll keep our fingers crossed, maybe this year. Trying to put a deal together there to kick the motor together and go out there for the week. It's just, you know, I haven't been there and you hear so many good stories about it. It's the, you know, it's the Daytona of sprint car racing. Yeah. So I'd like to try and get out there this year.
Okay. With your indoor experience, did you ever run the Chili Bowl?
Yeah.
And? Yeah. Was it enjoyable? Or
Yeah, it's awesome. It's awesome. It's a week-long great racing. I mean, it's all you got five qualifying nights. Every race is awesome. And then feature time, Saturday, you can't beat it. But I actually missed a show there 1 year by one spot. I drove for Steve Buckwalter. And I was in, started 10th. I was up to 4th on the bottom. And just like that, the bottom went away. 4th to 8th.
Okay. ARDC was at Linda's last week, and Danny Stratton won. And it's supposedly the return to their origins, the short tracks, the quarter miles. And do you really think that, I mean, they had 16 cars there, and even the president, ARDC president, said they have 30 cars registered and they're happy for, you know, at least half showing up. Is there something ARDC can do to entice more cars to come to the events? I believe they only had 13 at Path Valley or whatever the case may be, but is there something that some of these traveling series can do? Because you said you have a lot of guys following All-Stars, but what can be done to follow a tour like ARDC?
I wish I had the answer. It's just, I think it's too far gone, the motor costs, stuff like that. You know, it's coming back, I think, with the smaller tracks for better racing. Right. Linda's was probably awesome. I wish I could have seen it.
Yeah, it was a good race.
Path Valley was a perfect track for him. Yeah. You know, and I think there's some more guys wanting to get in them if they can just bring the cost down to the motor. You know, and they went to the USAC rules with the motor combinations, okay, and to try and pull some of them guys to come in, and it just didn't seem to happen that way. So, you know, it's hard to say what to do. I'm not a ARDC president or nothing like that, so I can't make the calls. But I'd like to see it come back because it's I think it's the best racing around. Wingless racing is where it's at.
Well, we saw that at the action track with the wingless 600s. Did you run wingless with your 600?
Yeah.
And then you did the 270s, but the 270s have the way, they very rarely have a wingless 270 race. Do you think that would be something that could pick up around the area? I know Mike Betts doesn't like to take the wings off the cars, but the 600 micros out there without a wing on are incredible in the same way with the action track. But do classes seem to have more fan appeal without the wing on, that they can actually see the drivers twisting and turning? And
I just think it makes for better racing, you know, especially a 600 because it's a lot of power, but when you got a wing on it, it kind of makes everybody the same speed. You take the wings off, it unhooks the cars. You can slide around a little bit. You know, you can move around the racetrack. Yeah. I think for them cars, it's better racing, especially with the tracks we have around here. 270s, I think they're better with the wing because you can shift. You have some more stuff there where you can make the car go faster.
Okay.
So it's the way it is now. It's pretty good. I mean, the action track, I didn't see a bad race there one time last year with the 600s. They're up against the fence. They have a little bit of a bottom there around the tires. I mean, that's like Indiana midget racing there.
And the nice thing about it is the winner doesn't come from the front row in the 600,
right,
no matter where you're running. The 600, they come from 14th, they come from 20th. They can put on a show and go 2-3 and sometimes 4 wide. With that being said, your mom and dad run Hamlin Speedway up in Hamlin, Pennsylvania. It's the fifth mile, what do you want to call it, semi-banked track?
Yeah, semi-banked.
Your mom's a go-kart racer, and your dad decided to eliminate the go-karts as a weekly class. How did that go over with the family, Ryan?
It went over pretty well because, you know, they were doing it where they ran the go-karts in the afternoon,
okay,
the micros and slingshots at night. And it just got to the point where you started at noon, by 11 o'clock at night, you're burned out. You know, and you can't have a good go-kart track, you know, track, right, surface-wise, and then have a good race that night because, you know, go-karts, you got to have a smooth, like this table here,
yeah,
and feature time for nighttime for the big cars, you got to have a little rough. You got to have a cushion, you know. So the old man just couldn't. It was just a lot of work, and he's enjoying a lot more now with just the three classes at night. You know?
With his stereo blasting at 15, and you can hear him going around the racetrack. Okay. With that being said, then, with the slingshot class up there, your dad was one of the original slingshot members. He was also the first slingshot dealer in 1999, and let me get this, if I'm wrong, please correct me, one of the first 10 slingshots ever built is still a winning car in your dad's racing stable?
I think it is probably, it's 2000, year 2000 car, so
yeah,
it's got to be one of the first.
It was one of the first 10.
Yeah, and it's probably about 10 pounds heavier now in welding wire, but just a good car. I mean, cars are, Richie's got a good thing going there with they're all the same. Back in 99, they're still the same now, you know, and so they don't lose their value. They don't work any better now than they did then, you know, so it's still...
It makes a driver out of you.
Makes for good racing, you know, it makes for good... You got to maintain it, you got to set it up, and just drive it.
Okay, now with that being said, the slingshots, their chassis built in 1999, still racing today. What is the shelf life of a sprint car chassis, Roy?
Well, 20 races.
Really?
Depending on what you got, I mean, we have one now. We have 15 shows on, and it's working good. So we're going to run it until it don't work anymore. But with a 410 in it, I should say.
Yeah.
You know, you put a 305 in it, 358, doesn't flex the car near as hard. So, but a 410, you're going 140 mile an hour, and they're not very big chassis. So you know, you're really working them. You got to have fresh stuff.
Okay. Randy.
Yeah, Jerry Higbee Jr. told me when you go from a modified to a midget, it's a completely different world. There's a real learning curve there because the midget drives totally different than the modifieds. So when you first jumped into a midget, was it tough to learn the midget, or was it like just a transition for you? Because you started smaller cars and moved
up. Yeah, it was pretty much a transition because a midget was a lot like a 600.
Okay.
You know, just a little bit more power, a little bit bigger car. Mm-hmm. So that was pretty close. When I went to a sprint car with a wing on top with the speed and racing in the air, that was a big transition for me.
Like I say, the dirty air, you have to learn how to use that.
Yeah, that's.
So you can't drive like a modified and kind of follow a guy. You have to kind of stay.
You can, yeah. You can maybe halfway down the straightaway, but when you get to the end of the straightaway, you got to get out here or here.
Oh,
otherwise,
okay.
Otherwise, you will never enter the
You can't take the same path as him, or you won't.
No. It's on a bigger track. Lincoln,
yeah,
you can.
Yeah.
But
I mean, like at the Grove, for example.
At the Grove, you'll be out of the park.
Okay.
Is there any wing restrictions on... is there a different wing restrictions between the World of Outlaws and the All-Star Sprints?
Wing restrictions?
As far as how big they can be, or...
They pretty much all have the same rules. It's 5x5, I think, is what they go by. And everybody runs the same stuff.
Okay. What about a front wing? Is that...
That's same deal. It's a little bit of a tech area, but, you know, it's all standard.
Have you run any URC shows?
I have not.
Really? No,
yeah.
Never?
Never.
Oh, okay.
Well, now, if you're, say you're out in Ohio running a show and there's a, you run the All-Star shows and there's a World of Outlaws show maybe like on a Tuesday night or something. It was a rain out and they brought them back. Or can you go to that show also with your All-Star car and just be legal and everything's fine and go
same
race?
Same car. Same everything.
Yep. Okay.
Same car, run Williams Grove.
Okay.
Central Pennsylvania. It's all the same rules.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Some of them have, you know, like the All-Stars have a, they're starting this new rule now with tethers for the front axle.
Oh, okay.
Which you don't have to use at Williams Grove. Some safety stuff, but
yeah.
Other than that, the cars and it's just the tire rules are all the same. Everything's the same.
That's good. Yeah.
Okay, now the dirt organization, I believe, don't they have it that you can't race a other sanctioning series other than the dirt or World of Outlaws or whatever before a night before or night after? Does the All-Star League have anything like that?
No.
Or is that just with the modifieds they have? Is that also for the sprints and the late models?
Do they have that deal in the sprint cars, really?
World of Outlaws, the platinum members, there's some kind of deal there.
But you might just be a one-night invader for that week or something. I mean,
right,
so you're just an outsider that can come in.
The All-Stars don't have that yet.
Oh, okay.
You like running Grandview in the Bob Miller Thunder in the Hill shows?
I enjoy that. Yeah. That's a fun track.
Is it really different from when, I mean, I've had plenty of guests on from Grandview, the race at Grandview. Is there a big difference from one end of the racetrack to the other? Everybody says the third turn is difficult to get to because you think you can actually take a nice access line in there, and when you get there, it's not really there.
Well, I mean, they're definitely two different corners, for sure. Okay. And the banking's different on both ends. The lighting's different on both ends, you know. And
when you go down the backstretch, the wall's kind of
The wall
like...
comes out.
Yeah, the wall really comes out. You're coming off, too. It gets really narrow there, but... When it gets slick there, it's fun. That's a fun track to drive.
Oh, okay.
Early on, when it's wet, it's like driving a fighter jet through a hallway. You know, it feels narrow.
Well, now, other than the All-Stars or the World of Outlaws, do you have any other racing going this year other than the sprints?
We're going to dabble with the Speedsters. It cuts down.
Okay.
Other than that, I'm just going to focus on 410s.
Is that a big difference? You come out with the Speedster and it feels like a...
Speedster feels like a... Yeah. Got the throttle pedal down through the floorboard.
Oh, okay.
You ran a Mahoning last year at the in the Speedster and you were doing good. And what happened after, was it about three laps ago or...
Well, I was falling out of the seat. I was tired.
Okay.
It was actually the day after I won the Outlaw show.
Yeah.
Okay.
We raced there, so I didn't get much sleep. But, that's a tough place just on the arms. I mean, that's a grueling... No, it's just a big circle.
Yeah, you never get a break to go down the straightaways. You're constantly turning.
Yeah, I couldn't that whole day. I didn't even work on the chassis. Mm-hmm. I worked on trying to get the steer easier. That was it because at three laps in practice, I couldn't steer. You know, and then they drew me to pole.
Oh, great! Yeah,
I was just figuring on going out and pulling in. Mm-hmm. But now I gotta make this happen now. You know, and five to go. It was a 40 lapper, which I don't know why it was 40 laps, but. What's that, Graver?
Yeah.
He started rolling me on the outside. So I stood up, sat up in the seat. I got five laps to go. I can do this. You know, I drove down to the one, I spun out to the 360. Never even stopped. And then the yellow was out for somebody else.
Yeah.
So they gave me your spot back.
Okay. Right? Okay.
Well, here when I did 360, I cracked the regular wheel. My regular tire was going down, so I went down to turn one and like this.
Yeah.
Truck. Yeah, I ended up second. But
do you like? I mean, did you drive them with the wings on when they had those elephant ears on the top, or you like it better without the?
I did. It was probably back. It was before they had power steering. Yeah. Before they had any of that. So. I actually was joking with Rich that day. I was driving at Grandview, just joking with him, and he took it pretty serious. I said, "Rich, let's stand the wing up here a little bit. I need some more downforce." "Oh yeah, yeah. If you have a gun," he said, "you can stand it up." I said, "Rich, I was only kidding." But yeah, he says it makes him better. But I mean, it's pretty good racing now.
Did you run the Fred Raymer show at Path Valley?
Yeah.
And Fred seems to be putting a lot of ideas and helping the racers out and the fans out. And Path Valley, it's. If you get to Carlisle, and you still got 45 minutes until you get to Path Valley, but it's a nice racetrack, big racetrack. Is that a racetrack, Ryan, that you think if they would actually move it closer to Central PA, you know, the Lincolns, the Williams Grove, that it might entice other drivers to show up? I mean, Raymer got a lot of guys with his special show last year, but do you think if it would actually move a little bit closer, it might bring some more cars in?
It's just a tick too far out there. Yeah, I mean, the way the track's set up, it's wide. It's kind of flat on the bottom. It's got some banking on the top. It's a good sprint car track for how small it is. And then, like I said, the midgets, wingless 600s there would be awesome. It's a good size. It's just a shame it's too far.
Yeah. Okay, you put on a show at Atlantic City in the indoor races, and you sat a couple years out now. Any plans on going back? I guess there's might be a new race announced for the Lehigh Valley area, but would you like to get back in and run indoor again?
Oh, I miss it. I enjoy going down there to watch. You know, it helped my old man out, the slingshots and stuff, but it was nice to take a couple of years off and just watch, because I took a pretty good tumble there.
Yeah.
4 or 5 years ago, and now it just seems like if you don't have one of them Lafflers, you might as well not even go. So if I can't get one of them, I'm just going to watch and maybe run a slingshot or something.
Now, can you run them at a place like Borgers or a place like Mahoning, or are they strictly an indoor?
Beyond, I don't know much about them. I think a couple guys ran them at Borders when they run the TQs there. I don't know if they're legal with the ATQ MRA. You have to try and find that out.
Okay. So when you teamed up with Don and Davey Brown, did Davey, in all his years of working on race cars, did he actually put something in your head that's been sticking there for a long time now?
Well, more Donnie. You know, he was always one to go to the racetrack. If it's off a little bit, make changes. Just keep trying things, you know. You keep trying things till you find something. And, you know, every time you go to the racetrack, you got something new. Racetrack surface is a little different. The tire is a little different size. You got a lot of different variables there. And if you're not trying anything, if you're going with the same package every time you go, it's like insanity.
Right.
You know, you're just doing the same thing over and over again, and nothing's changing. So that was the biggest thing I learned, is you got to keep trying things.
And no, I know Davey at the Reading Fairgrounds, when Toby Tobias would go out and race the car, he'd just stand there by the fence and just listen to it go by. And he'd come in and Toby would just get out of the car, he'd take the hood off, and he'd know exactly what to do. I mean, him with his ears in tune with the motors, and he was the perfect man. I mean, he just could make a little adjustment here and there, and the thing would click, you know.
Yeah.
And I bet you miss somebody like that on your team, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's 80 years old. And
yeah, I mean, he's still sharp as can be. Yeah,
yeah. He doesn't say much either when you're at
the
racetrack.
No, he's real quiet. Yeah.
Yeah, so whatever he does say, you got to make sure you hear him, because, you know, it's usually pretty well worth it.
Do you spend more time prepping your race car for All-Star Sprint, or do you basically do the same, like a list and stuff, for even if you're running Williams Grove?
You got to do the same stuff every week. You know, I mean, if you got races are won in the shop, so you got to spend as much time as you can in there to try and, you know, if it's scaling the car, if it's messing with tires, or just even sitting down and thinking about new setups. You know, you got to spend time in the shop, and that's where the races are won.
Okay, with that, you said you've been to some new tracks already, and you don't have any notes to go by. Is there a generic setup that you have that you base the night or the racetrack on how you feel from that, or do you go thinking it's a 3/8 mile track, you're going to set it up as you're going to be able to run a 3/8 mile racetrack?
More of that. You know, I watch videos. You can see videos now from, you know, for last week.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, so you can always do some research that way. And then you compare the racetrack to what you race around here. Set it up accordingly.
Okay. Now, Kutztown, the action track, they're making some more changes. They're going to make access into the third turn better. They increased the banking and everything, the gradual banking. As a race car driver, do you actually feel the difference in the banking from, you know, driving on the bottom to maybe, you know, two grooves up? Can you actually feel the difference in the way the car handles or the actual tracks propelling you around the racetrack?
Oh, definitely. Between that and the surface, you know, if the bottom's just dead slick and you should get up on the banking, there's some moisture up there, then that's where you got to be. But the banking, I mean, you definitely feel it. Sometimes it doesn't really help the car at all, but you can tell it's there.
How can you actually pinpoint, Ryan, when the track actually rubbers up? Can you actually see it? Can you actually see it?
It almost turns like a purple at the racetrack. I mean, it's you feel it before you really see it. I mean, it looks like it could, depending on how dusty or dirty the racetrack is, depending on how cool it is that night, and whatever's racing with you. So it's more of a feel. You know, three laps in a row, you come off turn four, and you sit there, you can't hook it up. And the fourth lap, you come by, and it
takes
sticks.
Off, yeah.
All right,
yeah.
I'm not going to hit that again next time. Mm-hmm. You
know? Is there a time, though, that you have too much power?
All the time, except for time trials.
Really?
Feature or heat race time, you know, there's so many ways of detuning these sprint cars because you got too much power.
I mean, because when I was down in the starter stand at Grandview, we had some new drivers come in, and you told the drivers sometimes you got to go slower to go faster, and they look at you like, you know, what are you talking about? But is it even that way in sprint cars? You know, can you manually adjust the wing as you're racing in a sprint car?
Yeah, you got the hydraulic handle right here. It's hooked to the power steering.
Okay.
You can move it probably about that far. So if you start with it up front, by the end of the feature, you got it back in the trunk, and it stands up a little bit. But when, you know, your tires are going away, fuel load's burning off, you got to hook the car up.
So you actually want more air down on the back tires?
Yeah, it's more rear pressure, yeah. Okay. More downforce on the rear tires.
Randy?
Now with the All-Stars, you're probably going to run the Ohio Speed Week, I would think, right? That's most their summertime thing. Are you going to come back for Pennsylvania Speed Week and Thunder in the Hill shows? Or
I'm going to try. We're going to kind of take it week by week here.
Okay.
You know, if we're up there in points and we're going to go for it, might not hit them all, but we're going to come back and hit a couple.
But the Ohio ones are basically
those you got to hit.
That's your shows, the All-Stars. Yeah.
We'll come back to PA, and, you know, if we're running well, and we'll run them all. It just all depends on how everything's going.
Oh, okay.
How much time a week do you spend in preparing a race car?
Well, I was there this morning at 9 o'clock, and it's 9 o'clock now, and I'm on my way home. So, you know, I'll go back down tomorrow. I mean, you can't spend enough time in the shop.
Do they normally race on a Saturday and Sunday, or Friday and Saturday with the All-Stars, or how do you?
It's all different. Normally Friday, Saturday.
So, I mean, you're not leaving like on every Thursday night or something that you have to head out to Ohio or wherever you're at? You know?
Yeah, like this weekend they come to PA.
Oh, okay, and so you're local in this week.
Right, and next weekend we're at Lernerville, Mercer. Which isn't too bad,
no.
Right, and then there's 2 weeks off. So.
Okay.
It's not an every weekend deal, which is nice.
Yeah, they give you that break to at least you know, get your equipment back up to par again.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, Bedford got rained out. Were you ever to Bedford before?
Yeah, I was there 2 years ago.
And it's a pretty, isn't it, back stretch goes uphill, front stretch goes downhill?
Like Mocatec used to be.
And the night I was there, they put too much water on it, and it was fast, wicked fast. It was rough, too. But they say it normally gets pretty slick and wide. I was hoping we could race there this past Sunday and have that, but didn't happen.
Okay. I was at Accord for the Gobbler last week. Jackie Brown Jr. won. Brett Deo show, fantastic show. That, to me, Ryan, I mean, it's high bank, quarter mile. That, to me, would be like the premier ideal sprint car racetrack.
That track there, now that you mentioned that, was just like Wayne County. Accord, the old Accord, how it was flat and banked. That's exactly like Wayne County was, except Accord you could probably see. But yeah, I mean, that's good racing, racetrack.
Now, many sprint car drivers, not many, but a lot of sprint car drivers, Casey Kane and Kyle Larson, and I guess Rico's got a ride in the K&N series now. You know, they've been moving up the ladder with their roots in sprint car and open wheel racing. Would you be accessible to take around? I mean, the truck series is at Pocono every year. ARCA runs at Pocono, both races every year. Would you like to try putting your talents in an ARCA car or a truck at Pocono and see what happens?
I'd love to have the shot and try once, just to see if I can do it. I'm happy where I'm at. I love 410 racing.
Don't the sprint car guys always want to go like to the Indy 500 though, or run those type of cars, or isn't that in your bag right now?
It's, you know, stock car racing, Indy car racing. Mm-hmm. I think the stock car route's probably a little bit easier to get to.
Okay.
You know, it all pays is about the same, but mm-hmm. I just like to have a shot one time just to try it.
Okay, your dad and uncle are modified racers. Why didn't you go that way?
That's a good question.
I had to ask it.
Too many Zeus buttons.
Oh, okay.
Know. No, I was just always an open wheel guy. Micros, midgets, sprint cars.
But, I mean, there came a time at Syracuse where the sprint cars had more body panels on than the modifieds. And it's becoming that way. You look at these cars now, they have the plexiglass up the side. They have all the... Is there any body restrictions or sheet metal restrictions in the Merit All-Star League or Outlaws?
I think the only thing is you can't have anything behind the rear axle. That's the only thing. But they're really...
So
really
you can actually, is there a chassis rule?
That's a good question. I don't think so.
So you can actually go with a modified, doctor it up with
it's got to be a sprint car looking thing. Okay. You can't go with a modified.
Okay.
But you can't get enough body panels on them. There ain't no room for
What them. Type of chassis are you running with the sprint car? Do you have a preference or?
Triple X.
Okay. Triple X. Those are good?
Yeah. A lot of guys are going to them now. Mm-hmm. You know, Raymer's cars are triple X.
Right, right.
Brett Marks, mm-hmm. Monteith.
Oh, okay.
As far as your safety, do you have a self-containment seat?
Yes.
You wear a Hans device?
Yep.
I see a lot of guys, they wear their driving gloves. It's almost like they can flip the fingers back so they can... Is there a certain kind of grip or something that you got to have in that steering wheel, Ryan, to make you feel comfortable?
I actually got, I think it's baseball tape on my wheel. As long as I got that, it don't matter what gloves I got on or anything like that. But if I got that baseball tape grip, that's what I like.
Okay, the question that everybody asks year after year, race after race, do you think sprint cars should have self-starters?
No. It's a sprint car. You're supposed to be pushed off. I don't think so. No.
Yeah, but a lot of people go like to a URC show, and if they're a modified fan, oh, we got to sit here while these guys get pushed off and line up. And, you know, if every time there's a red or even a yellow, sometimes they stop. And then you got to wait till they get bored or just sick of watching them get pushed off. You think that's really a good thing?
I do.
Okay.
Because that's, I mean, how many years now, that's how it's always been.
Right, right.
And if you really got to think about it, to have a starter on a sprint car, mm-hmm. you're going to need a battery, you're going to need a starter, and a flywheel, you're going to need
okay.
clutch, transmission.
Which would basically,
before you know it,
it's a modified.
You might as well have a modified. Yeah. Put a couple extra body panels
on it. Yeah, there you go, exactly, yeah.
Okay, now... Do you help your dad at Hamlin when time permits, or does he realize that you have your racing duties, and do you work with the family as far as helping the racetrack, or are you at S&S and helping there, or do you...
I try and mainly take care of S&S, the go-karts, and our slingshot dealer stuff, and got a lot of cars coming in for work, parts. I take care of that, and I try and get up there to help him, but he does it his own way, so I kind of stay back. You know, give him a hint if he needs it.
Okay. Now, All-Star League, you're not allowed. Are you allowed spotters in any of these?
No spotters
in any series.
Do they talk to you like Grandview? Yeah, the one-way radio. They can tell you like 94, go up to 6 spot or whatever. Okay.
That's mandatory.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay, so you're in the shop almost every day. Do you have guys that come in the shop and have specific duties, or do they just come in and you say you can do the tires, you can do the shocks, and... Or is it a job related?
Well,
job?
That's probably half the battle with sprint or racing in general is having a good crew. And I've actually got 3 or 4 good guys now. One guy takes care of the motor, the other guy does tires. You know, and they all kind of know what they got to do. So, and when we get to the racetrack, I'm still working on that. I got a lot of guys that want to show up and help at the track.
Okay.
But then you got your 3 guys in the shop. You can't take it away from them either. So good help's hard to find. I found some good help, and I'm trying to get them to work together a little better and have their own jobs. Well, just keep doing it more and more, and it gets easier, you know.
Okay, now after a night at Grandview or Bridgeport or New Egypt, modified guys will either go to the car wash or they'll strip things down. Do you strip the 94 down after every race?
We try to. We're trying to get more and more into doing that because we're on the road more. When we just ran Williams Grove, we just loaded up and went back to the shop. washed it there. Okay. But now that we're on the road, we're trying to get in the habit of stripping it at the track. That way we can roll it out and wash it, car wash.
Well, now like in Arizona, you guys were working in the hotel parking lot. Yeah. I mean, getting, is that a kind of life you like? Or
I enjoy that.
Okay.
I really do. Living out of a suitcase. Yeah. Okay. Living on the road. I kind of, rolled out in the morning.
Okay.
Put it up on stands, maintenance, loaded up for racing.
Do you get like fans that come around and check and watch and look at you?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they want to see what you're doing to the car.
Try to sell them shirts.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Feel money.
Do you have merchandise? Do you have new merchandise to sell, Ryan?
Yeah. Actually, we're working on a new t-shirt right now, that Classic Ink. Do nice work.
Okay. You have a website?
Yep. RyanSmithRacing.com.
Facebook page?
Got it all. It's all the same, Ryan Smith Racing.
Everything's, even on Twitter that way?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Who decided on the chassis that you run?
Well, we were on GF1s last year, probably till August, September. And it just seemed like we were having, both had 20 races on them. Couldn't get them to work anymore. It was tough to get the right setup, the right combination.
Mm-hmm.
And the box was getting smaller and smaller to be good.
Okay.
So we worked a deal with Poncho down there at Poncho's, and he hooked us up with a Triple X, and we put that together, and it was like a whole new race car.
Mm.
Same parts. We took off the GF1, bolted on the Triple X, and it was fast.
Well, now, with the sprint cars, do you put weight on like the modifieds do, or do you just try to take as much off as you can?
Yeah, we're taking off.
So you want it as light as possible?
Everything's titanium. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
What engine builder, Ryan?
HP Engines out of Thompsontown, okay. Port Royal.
And shocks?
Slade Pros.
Who?
Eric Slade.
Oh.
Pro Shocks.
Okay. Did you ever try TSLs? Timmy Buck?
Yeah, I had Timmy doing mine last year, actually.
Oh, yeah?
Just we couldn't get the right combination, and my crew chief was with Eric Slade. They were good friends, so he right away got a set of those things. And I've been actually in contact with Timmy here about getting working on a new package for this year. So.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so you're going to have the week's off for the All-Star Series. Are you going to stay in central Pennsylvania, or are you going to try to venture off to some of these tracks that you know they're coming up just to see what you got to work with?
We'll probably just run the Grove on Fridays when okay. We're off.
Now, you were in the top 10 in points at Williams Grove last year. Was it worthwhile as far as the point fund?
It definitely helps. Absolutely.
So,
it's just tough. For me, it was hard to get, like this year, I wanted to kind of do some new stuff.
Right.
So I didn't want to get locked in that every Friday night at Williams Grove. I mean, I love the place, great facility, yeah. Racetracks. I mean, there's so much nostalgia there, you know, mm-hmm. and racing there. But at the same time, I wanted to get out and do some new things.
Is there a minimum payout for the All-Stars? You won $5,000 in Ohio. Is there races where you're going to go to where it only pays like $1,500, or is there a minimum that they pay out to the winner?
I think it's always going to be at least $4,000. 400 start.
And then your point fund is?
I think it's 30 grand.
That's not bad, yeah.
Well, must you actually be a member of the All-Star League, or is it just show up and race?
No, you got to be a member to be eligible for point fund and tow money.
Do you have to make all the shows or pretty a certain amount of the shows?
You can do what you can, yeah. But I mean,
say they have 40 races and you make 37 of them, that's what they want, something like that.
Yeah.
But suppose you only make like 25,
you can still be a member.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, what's the closest, for the fans in the area, we're coming down to like 2 minutes. Closest racetracks around here in the All-Star Series that they can see yet, Ryan?
Well, this Friday, Williams Grove, Saturday, Port Royal for the Weicker Memorial.
Okay.
That's a nice paying race.
It's 15 to win.
Yeah, that's nice.
next week, Lernerville Friday, Mercer Saturday. And then, like I said, they're off. And then back to Ohio, 2 weeks.
Okay, and quick give a plug for Dad's Track. What's going on up at Hamlin?
Yeah, the old Hamlin Speedway. This Saturday, we've got 600s, wingless, 270s, winged, slingshots, stage ones, the whole nine yards. Actually, we had 20 juniors there Saturday.
Yeah. Oh, and for any of you old racers, old-time racers, heavy racers like me, Hamlin has what's called the supers for the slingshots. It's what? 35 and over, and the car has to weigh over 800 pounds.
Yep.
So there you go. Mm. So if you're heavy like me and old like me and want to get into racing, Hamlin Speedway does have the Super Series for us old overweight drivers, and that can still get in a race car and race.
And the fans can see at Kutztown also this year, right?
Yes,
yep, absolutely.
Okay. And Ryan will be at the action track running the number 79.
97.
The 97, it's still orange?
No, it's white and blue.
Well, you changed the colors. Wow. Gee, everything changed. Yeah. So you can see Ryan at the Action Track on Wednesday nights. He'll be at Williams Grove this Friday night. So on behalf of Ryan Smith, Randy Kane, I'm Mike Feltenberger. Thank you and have a good evening.